إن الحمد لله نحمده ونستعينه ونستغفره ونعوذ بالله من شرور أنفسنا ومن سيئات أعمالنا من يهدي الله فلا مضل له ومن يضلل فلا هادي له وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له وأشهد أن محمدا عبده ورسوله يا أيها الذين آمنوا اتقوا الله حق تقاته ولا تموتن إلا وأنتم مسلمون يا أيها الناس اتقوا ربكم الذي خلقكم من نفس واحدة وخلق منها زوجها وبث منهما رجالا كثيرا ونساء واتقوا الله الذي تساءلون به والأرحام إن الله كان عليكم رقيبا يا أيها الذين آمنوا اتقوا الله وقولوا قولا سديدا يصلح لكم أعمالكم ويغفر لكم ذنوبكم ومن يطع الله ورسوله فقد فاز فوزا عظيما أما بعد فإن أصدق الحديث كتاب الله وخير الهدي هدي محمد صلى الله عليه وسلم وشر الأمور محدثاتها وكل محدثة بدعة وكل بدعة ضلالة وكل ضلالة في النار. Brothers and sisters, the topic that I was given was based on a hadith that was narrated by Tirmidhi rahimahullah ta'ala in his jami', and he said it is a hadith that is hasan and sahih, that the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he said, لَا تَزُولُ قَدَمَ الْعَبْدِ يَوْمَ الْقِيَامَةِ حَتَّى يُسْأَلَ عَنْ أَرْبَعٍ, that the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he said that the slave's feet will not move from his place on the Day of Judgment حَتَّى يُسْأَلَ عَنْ أَرْبَعٍ, until he is asked about four things. These four things that you're going to be asked about before your feet move on the Day of Judgment. And we have to understand this, the position that this is. يعني, because this is not something that is, you know, it's not something small that your feet aren't going to move. Because you're going to be there on the Day of Judgment. That the day that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala described, this is, أَلَا يَظُنُّ أُولَٰئِكَ أَنَّهُمْ مَبْعُوثُونَ لِيَوْمٍ عَظِيمٍ. He said, do these people not understand, or do they not think that they're going to be raised لِيَوْمٍ عَظِيمٍ? So Al-Azim, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the great, described this day as Al-Azim, يَوْمٌ عَظِيمٌ, as this great, this day that is great. So the most greatest described this day as a great day, لِيَوْمٍ عَظِيمٌ. What is this day? He said, يَوْمَ يَقُومُ النَّاسُ لِرَبِّ الْعَالَمِينَ, the day when the people, they will stand for رَبُّ الْعَالَمِينَ, the Lord of the creations. This is what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala described this day. And your feet are not going to move on that day until you answer these four questions. You know, the day that the sun will come closer to you than a meal. They say, the hadith, a meal. The sun will come that close to you. On that day where the people, they, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala describes them and he says, يَوْمَ وَتَرَى النَّاسَ سُكَارَى وَمَا هُمْ بِسُكَارَى. You're going to see the people as if they're drunk. وَمَا هُمْ بِسُكَارَى. They're not really drunk. وَلَكِنَّ عَذَابَ اللَّهِ شَدِيدٌ, but the punishment of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is shadeed, is severe. This is the day that we're talking about, that your feet are not going to move until you answer these four questions. That the sun is going to be that close. And in the hadith of Al-Bukhari, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam describes this, and he said that the people will be waiting for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in that heat, for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to make his judgment between the creation. So before the Day of Judgment, the actual judgment starts, then we're going to be waiting for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to come. Then the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam will go and give his shafa'ah, the intercession in front of Allah, so Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala can come and decide and rule between the slaves, rule between us. So this is something that is something big, that you're not going to move until you answer these questions. On that hard state where some people are going to be drowning in their sins, and people are going to be burning in under the sun, and some people are not going to have any shade. Those people who do not have any shade, they're not going to have any shade on that day. And there is no shade on that day except for the shade that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gives. This is the day that we're talking about, that your feet are not going to move. So don't think that when we say that your feet are not going to move is something small. The fact that your feet are not going to move means you're not moving from your place until you answer these questions in front of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in the Quran, فَلَنَسْأَلَنَّ الَّذِينَ أُرْسِلَ إِلَيْهِمْ وَلَنَسْأَلَنَّ الْمُرْسَلِينَ. We're going to ask those people who were sent to, meaning us, everyone. They are going to be asked, فَلَنَسْأَلَنَّ الَّذِينَ أُرْسِلَ إِلَيْهِمْ وَلَنَسْأَلَنَّ الْمُرْسَلِينَ. And not just us, we're going to be asked, no. Also the messengers, وَلَنَسْأَلَنَّ الْمُرْسَلِينَ. We're definitely going to ask these messengers as well. The Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and all of the messengers before him are going to be asked on that day. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is going to be asked. So this is not something that is small. Allah says in another ayah in the Quran, فَوَرَبِّكَ لَنَسْأَلَنَّهُمْ أَجْمَعِينَ. I swear by your Lord, we're going to ask all of them, every single one of them, لَنَسْأَلَنَّهُمْ أَجْمَعِينَ, all of them, عَمَّا كَانُوا يَعْمَلُونَ. On what are they going to be asked? What did they used to do? These are the things that, so this question of their judgment is a real responsibility, that what you used to do in this life, is something that you're going to be questioned about. Every single thing, everything that you do is going to be questioned about. That's why the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he said that ma min ahadin minkum, there's not going to be any one of you, none of you, illa, except that he's going to have a private, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is going to ask him privately, one on one. Laysa baynahu wa baynahu turjuman. There's not going to be any translator between you and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala on that day. And then the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam describes that, and he said, he looks in front of them, فَلَا يَرَى إِلَّا مَا قَدَّمْ. He looks in front of him and he does not see anything except for what he put forth with his own hands, meaning his actions. You're not going to see anything except for that. So this is the point that I'm trying to make at the beginning of this lecture, is that this is a real responsibility. The responsibility that is upon you is going to be asked upon the Day of Judgment. Just like the hadith that Sheikh Abdul Rahman spoke about, كُلُّكُمْ رَاعٍ وَكُلُّكُمْ مَسْؤُولٍ عَنْ رَعِيَّتِهِ. Every single one of you are shepherds, and every single one of you are going to be asked about that. This is the مسؤوليه, the responsibility that we need to have in our heart. That you know that I'm going to be asked about 1, 2, 3, 4, all of these things. You're going to be asked about it. So the smart person is who? The smart person is the one who knows before the exam comes, he knows the questions, so he prepares for the answers. Allah gave us the questions that you're going to ask. I'm going to tell you the four questions, inshallah. Allah tells us the questions that you're going to be asked. So who's going to be stupid enough to come to an exam where the questions and the answers were given to him and he still fails the exam? This is what you need to understand. This is the responsibility that you have on this day, on that day. So the first thing, Allah subhanahu, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he said in the hadith that was narrated by Tirmidhi, and he said it's hadithun hasanun sahih, that the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he said, لا تزول قدم العبد يوم القيامة, that the two feet of the slave on the Day of Judgment will not move, حتى يسأل عن أربع, until he's asked about four things. And some say five, and you're going to see why, because one of the things can be counted as two. So the first thing he says, عن عمره فيما أفناه. The first thing that you're going to be asked about is your life. Your life and how you spent it. Your life and how you spent it. And the ulama, when they speak about this, they say that what the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam is talking about is what you've done for your whole life. From the beginning to the end, you're going to be asked, what did you spend your life doing? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala tells us about the reason why we were created, you know? Allah says, وَمَا خَلَقْتُ الْجِنَّ وَالْإِنسَ إِلَّا لِيَعْبُدُونَ, that we did not create the jinn and the humans, إِلَّا لِيَعْبُدُونَ, except to worship me. So this is what you're going to be asked about. What did you do on that day, the Day of Judgment? What did you do? I mean, what did you do in the dunya with your life? That's the first thing. The Prophet, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, speaks about the people who are in the hellfire. And he said about them, he asked them a question, and he says, أَوَلَمْ نُعَمِّرْكُمْ مَا يَتَذَكَّرُ فِيهِ مَنْ تَذَكَّرُ وَجَاءَكُمُ النَّذِيرُ فَذُوقُوا فَمَا لِلظَّالِمِينَ مِنْ نَصِيرٍ. The people who are in the hellfire, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is going to say to them, did we not give you, nu'ammirkum, did we not give you a long life? The same word that was used in the hadith that you're going to be asked about, your umur, your life. Allah says, أَوَلَمْ نُعَمِّرْكُمْ مَا يَتَذَكَّرُ فِيهِ مَنْ تَذَكَّرُ. Did we not give you a long enough life for you, for the person who is able to remember, meaning to receive the admonition from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? Did we not give you enough life for you to receive the admonition or not? أَوَلَمْ نُعَمِّرْكُمْ مَا يَتَذَكَّرُ فِيهِ مَنْ تَذَكَّرُ وَجَاءَكُمُ النَّذِيرُ, and the warner also came to you. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam told us what's going to happen. It came to you as a warner, بَشِيرًا وَنَذِيرًا, as a person giving good news and also a person who is warning. This is the warning that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is talking about. Your life, what did you spend your life in? That's number one. Number two, and that was the other three, inshallah ta'ala, is a bit more detailed, because that one is general, your whole life. And the rest are specific about certain aspects of your life. So know that you're going to be asked about your whole life, and specifically you're going to be asked about certain aspects of that life. So he said, عَنْ عُمْرِهِ فِيمَا أَفْنَاهِ وَعَنْ شَبَابِهِ فِيمَا أَبْلَاهِ. You're going to be asked about your youth. I see most of us say our youth, alhamdulillah. So this is going to be directly asked, this is directly for you. That your youth, fima ablah. Your youth, what did you, you know, ablah means is like the Arabs, when they say ablah, ablah thawb, your cloth became old. What did you do with your youth in terms of meaning? When your life was still new, like your clothes, when your life was still new, what did you do with your life? When you had that ability to go and pray, when you had the ability to go and do things at your young age, when you had the ability, what did you do with that life? And the reason why you're going to be asked about this is because the person who's at a young age, number one, he has more desires. You have more desires at a young age than you have when you're at an older age. So the haram, the things that are haram, are easier for you to do when a person is at a young age. ولذلك, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he said about سَبْعَةٌ يُظِلُّهُمُ اللَّهُ فِي ظِلِّهِ يَوْمَ لَا ظِلَّ إِلَّا ظِلُّهُ. On the day that seven will be under the shade of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, on the day when there is no shade except for that his shade, is what? One of them, شَابٌ نَشَأَ فِي عِبَادَةِ اللَّهِ. شَابٌ نَشَأَ فِي عِبَادَةِ اللَّهِ. A youth, a young man who was raised with the worship of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So look at the contrast. You have a contrast of a person who wasted his youth. He's going to be asked about it. What did you do with your youth? And on the other side, the great reward for that person who takes that youth and he, you know, takes advantage of this time that he has, the youth. That person will be under the shade of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And we just said that the sun on that day will be close, will be so close to us that we need shade. And there will be no shade except for the person who Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gives shade. And from amongst those is a youth who was raised in the worship of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. You know, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala praises a person a lot when they take advantage of the youth, to the point that wallahi Allah mentions in the Quran a story of a group of youth who took advantage of the youth and they fought against their desires despite having that ability to do so much haram. Allah praises them and mentions them in the Quran to be recited until the day of judgment. Who are those youth? لا أي الكهف أصحاب الكهف سير بعد أخي أصحاب الكهف the people of the cave. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says إنهم كأنهم فتية آمنوا بربهم وزدناهم هدى. They were a group of youth who believed in their Lord, so Allah increased them in their Lord and in their guidance. Their people, their group of youth, آمنوا بربهم فزدناهم هدى. We increased them in their guidance. And Allah mentions their story until the day of judgment. يعني until the day of judgment, this Quran is going to be recited. And people are going to be reciting the Quran until the day of judgment. And they will be reciting about these people, the group of the youth, who took advantage of their life. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentions ayat, the signs that He gave to these people just because they fought against their desires, especially at that young age. So that's the second thing. وَعَنْ شَبَابِهِ فِي مَا أَفْنَاهِ. Your youth, what did you spend it in? You're going to be asked about that. Yeah, you're able right now to stand at night to pray. You're able right now to memorize very easily. People who are older, they can't memorize very fast. So memorize Quran, I mean, hadith and things like that. Seek knowledge. People who are older, they find it harder. Not saying that they can't. It's very possible. In fact, they mentioned that Ibn al-Jawzi, rahimahullah ta'ala, or Ibn al-Aqil al-Nahwi, the one who wrote the Alfiyyat ibn Malik, he said that on the day of his death, he memorized khamsa shawahid, five evidences for Nahw. And he mentioned, he memorized on the day of his death. And that's the important thing. For khamsa shawahid, on the day of his death, he memorized. So I'm not trying to say that a person who's older can't memorize and can't seek knowledge and can't do good deeds. No. Lakin, the person who's at his youth, you have the advantage over the other people. You have advantage. And you're going to be asked about the advantage. Don't think that it's just like, you know, people, Allah gave it to me so I could do what I want with it. No. Wallah, Allah gave it to you for you to act by it, and that act will be asked about on the day of judgment. So, عن شبابه فيما أبلاه. And the third one, he said, وعن ماله من أين اكتسبه وفيما أنفق. You're going to be asked about your wealth, the wealth that you have. You're going to be asked, where did you get it from? And when? How did you spend it? And you know, we need to go in a bit of detail about this. Because you have to understand that today we live in a world where it is, the society is full of riba. Full of riba. A person, if you're not paying riba, you're taking riba. If you're not taking riba, you're connected to a lot of people. I'm not saying everyone. A lot of people are connected to riba. And this is something that you're going to be asked about on the Day of Judgment. Every single one of you are going to be asked about, how did you get your wealth and where did you spend it in? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala describes the person who takes riba and he says, الَّذِينَ يَأْكُلُونَ الرِّبَا لَا يَقُومُونَ إِلَّا كَمَا يَقُومُ الَّذِي يَتَخَبَّطُهُ الشَّيْطَانُ مِنَ الْمَسِ. The person who eats riba, and the reason why we say eat is because when you take money, when you get money, a lot of the money that you spend on it is for food, right? That person that you got that money, he eats with that food, with that money that he got from riba. Allah says, الَّذِينَ يَأْكُلُونَ الرِّبَى, those people who eat riba, لَا يَقُومُ الَّذِينَ يَأْكُلُونَ الرِّبَى لَا يَقُومُونَ, they will not stand on the Day of Judgment, إِلَّا كَمَا يَقُومُ الَّذِي يَتَخَبَّطُهُ الشَّيْطَانُ مِنَ الْمَسِ, except like the one who الشيطان possessed him, a jinn possessed that person on that Day of Judgment. That's how it's going to be look like, from that hard punishment that he done, from the hard sin that he done, the punishment is so severe that he will be looking like a person who is possessed by a shaitan. You know, Allah says about the person who takes riba, فَأَذَنُوا بِحَرْبٍ مِّنَ اللَّهِ وَرَسُولِهِ, have a announcement of a war with Allah and His Messenger, the person who takes riba. ولذلك the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam, or sorry, Ibn Abbas radiallahu anhuma, he said that in the explanation of this ayah, that on that day the angels will give this person a sword, and he will say to him, go in front of Allah and fight Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And he will not be able to fight Allah. Obviously, you can't, no one can fight Allah. Like, and this is from the punishment that a person takes riba. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he said, in Sunan al-Bayhaqi, لَعَنَ اللَّهُ آكِلَ الرِّبَى وَمُوكِلَهُ وَشَاهِدَيْهِ وَكَاتِبَهُ, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam cursed the one who eats riba, meaning he gives loan or something like that, and he takes it and he eats from that riba. Because riba is oppression, interest. What I mean by riba, sorry, interest. When a person, you give someone money and you take money back with extra. So you give someone £1,000, you say, I want it back, £2,000. This is interest, this is riba. This is the riba that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala put on it, this severe punishment. That the person on that, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he said, لَعَنَ اللَّهُ آكِلَ الرِّبَى, the one who eats riba, he's cursed. And the one who, not just the one who eats it, huh? Not the one, just the one who takes it, the one who also pays it. You agree to a contract in it as riba, Allah subhanahu, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam cursed that person. وَشَاهِدَيْهِ, not even that, also the one who witnesses to riba. So you, there's a contract between two people, you become the witness for the contract. And in this contract is some riba. That person is also cursed by the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And the last one is وَكَاتِبَهُ, the one who writes the contract, the lawyer who writes the contract. The lawyer who writes a contract of riba, he's also cursed. All of those four people are cursed. And this is something that you have to understand, that you're going to be asked about all the wealth that you get. Did you sell alcohol in your shop? You know, some people, they sell haram things. They sell alcohol. This is, again, you're going to be asked about that. وَفِيمَا أَنفَقْ, number two, is how did you spend your money? How did you spend your money? Did you spend it in something that's halal, or did you spend it in something that's haram? That's number one. And another way that you can also look at this is, did you spend it in the things that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala obliged for you to spend it in? And the biggest thing that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala obliged for you to spend it in, and this is something that a lot of people, a lot of youth especially, a lot of youth, they are, you know, they don't really remember it much. And that is the person who has to pay zakah. Zakah is the biggest haqq that Allah has upon you in your wealth. The biggest haqq, the biggest right that Allah has upon you in your wealth is for you to pay the zakah. ولذلك the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, when he was counting the pillars of Islam, he said, الشهادتين, الصلاة, and zakah. Zakah, the third pillar of Islam. So people need to look at their money. Do I have the money? You have to learn. You have to learn about the zakah. You have to learn about the money that you have to spend, when you have to pay zakah, how to pay zakah, and all of that. This is the biggest right that you're going to be asked upon when it comes to how did you spend your money. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala tells us about in the Quran about the person who does not give the zakah, and he says in the Quran, يَوْمَ يُحْمَى عَلَيْهَا فِي نَارِ جَهَنَّمْ فَتُكْوَى بِهَا جُبَاهُهُمْ وَجُنُوبُهُمْ وَظُهُورُهُمْ هَذَا مَا كَنَزْتُمْ لِأَنفُسِكُمْ فَذُوقُوا مَا كُنْتُمْ تَكْنِزُونَ. He said, on that day, يَوْمَ يُحْمَى عَلَيْهَا فِي نَارِ جَهَنَّمْ, they will be strangled in that day, on the Day of Judgment. فِي نَارِ جَهَنَّمْ, in the hellfire. فَتُكْوَى بِهَا جِبَاهُهُمْ وَجُنُوبُهُمْ وَظُهُورُهُمْ, the whole body, the front, and their side, and their back is going to be squeezed by a, in the hadith, the Prophet ﷺ described it as a snake that is squeezing this person in the grave. And you say, ذُوقُوا مَا كُنْتُمْ تَكْنِزُونَ, those people who do not spend the money, their money in zakah, it will be said to them by this, on this punishment, taste what you used to hoard and used to hold on, and you never used to give it in zakah. This is again a big right that you have, that the money has upon you. Another type, that's the right of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. That money of zakah is not your money. You don't own that money. Meaning, if you have that money in there, that's you're taking money that you have taken from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. That money is the right of Allah azza wa jal, and it's a right to the poor people. So So you have no right to that money. No, you have no right to keep that money. ولذلك أبو بكر الصديق رضي الله عنه, when the Arabs, after the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam died, a lot of the Arabs, they refused to give zakah. So what did Abu Bakr do? He fought against them. He sent armies against these people to take the zakah. And he said, wallahi, if they don't give me a rope that they used to give to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, I will fight them for that rope. Because they used to give that money in zakah. And I will fight them until they give the zakah. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he said, أُمِرْتُ أَنْ أُقَاتِلَ النَّاسَ حَتَّى يَشْهَدُوا أَنْ لَا إِلَهَ إِلَّا اللَّهُ وَأَنِّي رَسُولُ اللَّهِ وَيُقِيمُ الصَّلَاةَ وَيُؤْتُ الزَّكَاةَ. I have been commanded to fight the people until they bear witness that there is nothing worthy of worship but Allah, and I am the messenger of Allah, and they pray the salah and they give the zakah. Again, a big right that you have on zakah. Below that right, which is still important, is the rights that the people have upon you. You know, your wife, she has a right upon you that you have to spend money on her. That the money that you have, so you have to spend it upon her. وَلِذَلِكَ, when the wife of Abu Sufyan came to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and he said, and she said that Abu Sufyan is a stingy man. He doesn't give me my money that I earn. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, what did he say? خذي ما يكفيك أنت وابنتك بالمعروف. Take what is enough for you without asking him. Take without asking him what is enough for you and for your daughter بالمعروف, as according to the customs. So this right that that your wife and your children have on you on the day of judgment, that you spend your money on those people who have rights upon you, your wife and your children. And also after that, your aqarib, your close family members, those poor family members that you have, they are the people who have the most right for you to give the money to. So how much is that so far? How yes. عن عمره. The first one is what? What's that? Your life. فيما أفناه. What did you spend your life on? Second one is? وَعَنْ شَبَابِهِ is like his youth, your youth. And فِيمَا أَبْلَاهُ, what did you spend your youth in? And your third one is? Your money. What about it? Where did you get it from and? How did you spend it? These are four things that, again, when are we going to be asked about this? On the day of judgment. And your feet are not going to move on that day until you're asked about these questions. So prepare for that question. And the last one is? وَعَنْ عِلْمِهِ فِيمَا عَمِلَ بِهِ, your knowledge. And this is two parts, inshallah. Your knowledge and how you acted by it. Your knowledge and how you acted by it. Your knowledge and how you acted by it. And we don't, but when we say this, we don't mean that you shouldn't learn. يعني, okay, I'm going to be asked about my knowledge, therefore I shouldn't learn, so I'm not going to be asked, right? Someone might think that. أعوذ بالله. لكن, the reality is that, and this is something that Ibn Hajj mentioned in his Madkhal Al-Maliki. He mentions the Madkhal, and Ibn Qayyim rahimahullah ta'ala also mentions this. He says that it is obligatory upon every single person to learn the knowledge that is obligatory upon him to act by. So if you now, you say, I don't want to learn how to pray Salah. A person doesn't learn how to pray Salah, and he's ignorant about Salah, and he's able to learn about it. Is he excused for this ignorance? Of course not, because he had to learn about it. He had to pray, therefore he had to learn about it. That's the first part that we talk about. Hajj, for example, a lot of people when they come to Mecca, they will ask weird questions. And you think, why didn't you learn before you come? You know, Allah, I know a person, he said to me, I came from Riyadh. Riyadh is 1,000 something kilometers away from Mecca. And he said, where do I do my ihram from? He's in Mecca. Where do I do my ihram from? And where do I get to my ihram? You have to do way before you come into Mecca. And he's really in Mecca. Yani, this person, is he excused for the ignorance? Of course not. He was able to go to a sheikh and ask him, how do I do Hajj? How do I do Umrah? When do I do this and that? This is something that you're going to be asked about, your knowledge. Did you learn it in the first place, number one? You're going to be asked about that. So don't just think that you're going to be asked about the knowledge that you already have. No. You're going to be asked about the knowledge, did you learn it in the first place? Because it was obligatory upon you to learn. Allah says, فَاسْأَلُوا أَهْلَ الذِّكْرِ إِن كُنْتُمْ لَا تَعْلَمُونَ. Ask the people of knowledge if you don't know. Therefore, it was obligatory upon you to learn. And then, also, the person who knows, okay, now you know, فِيمَا عَمِلَ بِهِ, what did you act by this knowledge? You know, today, maybe today you learned something. You learned that zakah was obligatory upon you. Did you act by it? You learned that Imam Ahmad, rahimahullah ta'ala, he said, I never heard a hadith except that I acted by it. Hatta, until the point that I heard that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam had done hijama, and he gave the person who's doing the hijama for him a dinar. So I done hijama, and I gave the person who's done hijama for me a dinar as well. Acting by this knowledge. And subhanAllah, there's a lot of barakat when it comes to acting by knowledge. In the Quran, Allah says in the Quran, وَالَّذِينَ جَاهَدُوا فِينا لَنَهْدِيَنَّهُمْ سُبُولَنَا. Those people who strive hard in our way, we're going to guide them to our paths. Ibn Abbas radiallahu anhuma, he said about this tafsir of this ayah, and Ibn Kathir mentioned this, and I think Ibn Jarir al-Tabri also mentioned this. He says that يَعْمَلُونَ بِمَا عَلِمُوا فَيَهْدِيهِمُ اللَّهُ لِمَا لَا يَعْلَمُ أو لِمَا لَمْ يَعْلَمُوا. They acted by what they knew, so Allah gave them the knowledge of what they did not know. Abu Sulaiman al-Darani, he was one of the from the early generations, he heard this. Someone said that to him. One of his students said this to him. And he said, subhanAllah, it's not befitting for a person to act by something that was in their heart until they hear it. So when they hear it, they act by it. So he started saying, alhamdulillah, that I already thought this. He used to see this in himself. He used to say, meaning, what the meaning of this is that he used to see in himself that I used to learn something and then I used to act by that same thing and Allah will give me more knowledge. And I never knew how. Until this, the tafsir of Ibn Abbas came to him. And he said, alhamdulillah. So he started saying alhamdulillah a lot because he learned this knowledge. That when you act by knowledge, more knowledge comes to you. Subhanallah. And that's something that was known amongst the Salaf. That whenever you act by knowledge, more knowledge will be given to you from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And this is from the barakah of acting by your knowledge. So you're going to be asked, an ilmihi, your knowledge, fima amila bih. How did you act by your knowledge? There was a hadith that was narrated by Al-Tabari in his tafsir, and also I think Al-Tirmidhi narrates it. And it's an authentic hadith that was authenticated by Shaykh Al-Albani, rahimahullah, that there was a man, he came to Medina, Al-Masjid Al-Nabawi in Medina, and he saw a man, and the people were gathering around this man. They were gathering around this man and he was giving out knowledge. He was teaching the people. So he said, I came so close to him until I was right in front of him. So I said to him, and he was Abu Huraira, teaching in the masjid of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And he said to him, Ya Abu Huraira, O Abu Huraira, teach me something that you heard from the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. وَعَقَلْتَهُ, and you understood it from the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. So Abu Huraira, he took a deep breath and he fainted. And then he got up after a bit. And so the man said again, I asked the question again, until there was hardly any people around, everyone left. And he said, O Abu Huraira, tell me about a hadith that you heard from the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, that you heard from him, سَمِعْتَهُ مِن رَسُولِ اللَّهِ صَلَّى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمَ وَعَقَلْتَهُ, and you understood it. So Abu Huraira, he took a breath again, and he fainted again. Then he got up, Abu Huraira got up, and he said, I'm going to tell you a hadith that I heard from the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and in this very masjid, Masjid al-Nabawi, in the masjid of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and I understood it from the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. He said that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is going to come on the Day of Judgment, and He's going to bring people. He's going to bring people on the Day of Judgment, three people. The first person is a qari, a person who had knowledge. A qari, you know, these days they use the word qari for someone who recites the Quran. But in the Salaf, they used to say it for a person who recites the Quran and understands and has fiqh of the deen. He understands the religion. So Allah will come and He will say to this qari, what did you do in this dunya? So the qari, he will say, I learned for your sake. I learned for your sake and I taught people for your sake. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will say to this person, كَذَبْتَ, you lied. And the angels will say to him, كَذَبْتَ, you have lied. And Allah will say, rather you said you became a qari and you learned this knowledge, so people can say about you, this person was a qari and this person was a alim. And وَقَدْ قِيلَ, and it was said about you this. And then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will say, take this person on his head first to the hellfire. Then the second person that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will come with on the Day of Judgment is a person who was jawad, he was very generous, he had a lot of money and he would spend it in the sake of Allah. He would spend it. Then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, what did you do in this dunya? He said, I made a lot of money and I spent it in your way. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will say, كَذَبْتَ, you have lied. And the angels will say, كَذَبْتَ, you have lied. Rather, you had this money and you spent it for people to say that you were someone who was generous. وَقَدْ قِيلَ, and it was said that you were generous. Take him away. Then the third person will be a mujahid, a person who went out for jihad fi sabilillah, to fight against the enemies of Allah. And he was said, Allah would say to him, what did you do? He would say, I fought until I died for your sake. So Allah said, Kadhabta, you have lied. And the angels will say, Kadhabta, you have lied. And it will be said to him, take him to the hellfire. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he said, Ya Aba Hurairah, O Abu Hurairah, these are the first three people with whom the hellfire will be ignited with. So think about this. You're going to be asked about that knowledge that you gained. Why did you gain about? Why did you gain it? How did you? What did you do with that knowledge that you gained? These are the first three people who will be held accountable on the Day of Judgment. An alim, a person who used to see, giving talks, giving you lectures. Person who was seeking the knowledge. But the reason why he was seeking the knowledge was so the people could say to him, you are alim and you're a qari. You're someone, you're a person of knowledge. This person is going to be the first person who's going to be thrown into the hellfire. أَوَّلُ مَن تُسِعِرَ بِهِمِ النَّارِ. The first people that the hellfire will be ignited with. So this is the fourth thing, the knowledge that you have. Did you actually learn the knowledge in the first place? And in the poet, Al-Imam Ibn Raslan al-Shafi'i mentioned in his kitab, Safwat al-Zubad, he said, وَعَالِمٌ بِعِلْمِهِ لَمْ يَعْمَلًا مُعَذَّبٌ مِنْ قَبْلِ عُبَّادِ الْوَثَنِ. The alim, the knowledge, the alim, the scholar, who did not act by his knowledge, he is going to be punished in the hellfire before the people who worship idols. Because the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, what did he say? These three people are the first people who will be thrown into the hellfire. أَوَّلُ مَن تُسِعِرَ بِهِمِ النَّارِ. The first people will be thrown into hellfire. So, ikhwan, have the sense of responsibility that you're going to be asked about your life. And what did you do with your life? This life was not given to you for free. أَيَحْسَبُ الْإِنسَانَ أَنْ يُتْرَكَ سُدَى. You think that the human being, Allah says, did the human being think that he's going to be left Suda? يعني Suda meaning لا ينهى ولا يؤمر. He's not going to be commanded, he's not going to be prohibited from anything. He's just going to be there like for no reason. عَبَثًا, for no reason, Allah created you. لا والله, Allah created for a reason. So you're going to be asked about that reason. عَنْ عُمْرِهِ, your life. How did you spend your life? وَعَنْ شَبَابِهِ فِيمَ أَبْلَى, and your youth, how did you spend your youth? وَعَنْ مَالِهِ, your wealth, where did you get it from? And when did you, how did you spend it? And your knowledge, did you act by that knowledge? And don't think that I don't have that knowledge. لَا, Allah, you have to learn that knowledge. And every single person is going to be asked. فَلَنَسْأَلَنَّ الَّذِينَ أُرْسِلَ إِلَيْهِمْ. Allah says, وَاللَّهِ, the lamb, فَلَا, the lamb is lamb al-qasam. فَلَنَسْأَلَنَّ, this is swear, is saying, وَاللَّهِ, and we're going to ask. لَنَسْأَلَنَّ, and the noon is noon al-tawqeed. We're definitely going to ask. فَلَنَسْأَلَنَّ الَّذِينَ أُرْسِلَ إِلَيْهِمْ, those ones who were sent to, and وَلَنَسْأَلَنَّ الْمُرْسَلِينَ, we're going to ask those people to who were sent. The messengers will also be asked. Nuh عليه الصلاة والسلام, and the prophets, they're going to be brought in front of them on the Day of Judgment. And this is from the tafsir of the ayah. وَكَذَلِكَ جَعَلْنَاكُمْ أُمَّةً وَسَطًا لِتَكُونُوا شُهَدَاءَ عَلَى النَّاسِ. We have made you a middle nation for you to be witnesses in front of people. You're going to be witnesses on other people. Meaning Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is going to call this ummah, the ummah of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, to witness against other people, the other nations. And in the tafsir of this ayah, they mention that the Prophet's nations, Nuh and Ibrahim and all of these prophets, the nations are going to be brought in front of Allah in the Day of Judgment. And they will say, they will be asked, did a messenger come to you? And they'll say, no messenger come to me. Nuh didn't come to us. They'll lie. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will ask Nuh and the other prophets, did you give them the message that I gave you? Nuh will say yes. The prophets will say yes. So Allah will ask them, who are your witnesses? How was your proof for this? So ask them, the people, ask the ummah of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, ask our ummah. So we will be called in front of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to witness against the other nations. And this is what it means. We're going to ask the messengers as well. Not just us. Nuh, Ibrahim, all of these prophets are going to be asked. Not just us. So this day of questioning, the day of hisab, you know, one of the days of the day of judgment is Yawmul Hisab, the day of al-hisab, of questioning. This is a responsibility you guys need to, everyone needs to have in their heart. Realize this intense sense of responsibility. When a brother, you know, when some people, they're head of a family, you're the father of a family, you feel a responsibility, a big responsibility of that family. You have people to look after. Wallah, you're going to be asking the day of judgment about yourself. What did you do? That responsibility is bigger than the responsibility of your family. So have that constantly in your mind. And remember this hadith, that you're going to be asked about these four things. هذا وصلى الله وسلم وبارك على عبده ورسوله نبينا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه أجمعين.